ambassador, because that's what New Zealanders do. I mean, you can't find a New Zealander anywhere in the world who isn't a self-appointed ambassador. So it started originally as something that I did just because I'm a Kiwi, and that's what Kiwis do. Our population is only 4 million people, and 1 million of us live overseas. Over a period of time, I was approached by New Zealand Tourism and Air New Zealand to take on a more official ambassador role, which I willingly did and have done for over a decade. And this award that I was given, it was for my services to television and tourism.
There was a lot more we wanted to ask Phil about New Zealand and his family's involvement in conservation efforts there. But time was limited, so Phil left us with a final word.
And just remember, as I say at the end of The Amazing Race, the world is waiting for you.
For a link to Phil's book, No Opportunity Wasted, visit this show page on worldfootprints.com.
In this destination spotlight, Sadra Azimi shines a spotlight on Iran from the Adventure Travel Show.
Iran is a completely different destination from the rest of the world. It's a big country with a lot of different ethnic groups that each have their own distinct culture in the different corners of the country. It's a country that has been there for as long as history. It's beautiful culture, beautiful landscape, great food, great cuisine. And the thing that lasts with people the longest is the hospitality that they see from people. Fortunately, Iran, for the past 30, 40 years, has been getting a lot of bad media rap. But right now, people are starting to go back increasingly more, going to Iran, and all of them have the same experience. They see the great hospitality of the people, and they see wonderful sights. And they love it. Any American that goes there and comes back recruits another 10 people to go. As far as different cultures and ethnic groups go, depending on the geographical position in the country, in the northwest we have Turks, in the west we have Kurds, Lors, we have Arabs in the south, we have Baluchs in the east. And the central Iran, you have Persians who are the dominant ethnic group. As far as sites go, the sites in Iran are incredibly diverse. They go back as far as 2,500 years BC. But the most important sites, you could include Persepolis, Pasargad, Naqsh-e-Rustam. These are the sites from Achaemenid area in around Shiraz. And then as you progress through the country, when you go north, you start to see more components of the Islamic culture. So some of the most beautiful mosques in the world, incredible Islamic architecture in Isfahan. And as you go northwest, you see the roots of Christianity in Iran. And so you see all kinds of these diverse sites. And the country is big, but it's also small enough that you can see all of this in a relatively short amount of time. Thank you.
Robert Rose is the executive producer and host of Raw Travel, an independently produced television show that invites viewers to enjoy an authentic travel experience through its lens. The show integrates voluntourism, ecotourism, and just pure raw travel. Robert shared some raw travel with us just after returning from a shoot in Africa.
We started off in South Africa, which some people jokingly called their locally Africa Light. Other people called it the livable Africa. But to me, it was still amazing because it was my first time on the continent. And the more official name is the Gateway to Africa. So a lot of people will start off in South Africa before getting a little deeper. And we did the same thing, started off there and then went to Ghana, which is a little more raw.
Mm-hmm. So speaking of raw, Raw Travel is an independent production. What was your inspiration for creating this series?
On the creative side, I've always been independent. And maybe that's because I'm not very good, or maybe it also speaks to the fact that I just don't work well under corporate structures. It's probably a little bit of both, maybe, but being independent has allowed me to grow as a creator. And the inspiration for this particular show was I had the opportunity to travel in my early 40s. I won't tell you how old I am now, but I'll tell you that I'm still in my 40s. But in my early 40s, I had the experience that most people have maybe in their 20s, if they have it at all, and then I sort of had like a gap year or a sabbatical and an opportunity where I didn't have to worry about money in the immediate future, and I could just travel and enjoy life and indulge my curiosity. And when I was able to do that, I lived abroad in Colombia, South America, for about 11 months. It was my base of operations, but I just traveled all throughout Latin America, practicing my Spanish, getting to know the different cultures. And what I found was basically what I considered really the way most people are traveling these days, but not the way that's, you know, really presented on television, especially in the United States, was the non-luxurious type of travel, the type of travel that was more authentic and real and incorporated, you know, giving back to others and living maybe a more socially conscious life, which is what travel inspired me to do. So I just wanted to share that with others.
Now, Robert, you start to touch on socially responsible travel and just doing things differently than travel shows that are currently on television. What's the premise behind Raw Travel TV?
Well, we have a, you know, a broad audience because we're broadcast TV. We're syndicated, so that means we're on ABC, NBC, Fox affiliates. So at any given time, and this was borne out recently when I was speaking at the Boston Travel Show, I have to be aware that the audience may be a bit more, a bit different than myself. But so I try to like serve both, be true to myself and also true to the audience, which can be a bit broad and in age and demographics and likes and dislikes. And so what I try to do is with the show, have this sort of broad overarching theme of socially responsible travel, which means, you know, taking care of the environment, being sustainable when you travel and live, and caring about others and about the planet, while at the same time having these adventures and travels and being curious about the world and trying to do it in such a way that it's not preachy, because I think that would turn people off. And basically, through my own experiences, show how you can both have fun and have life-changing experiences at the same time. And isn't that really what it's all about? I mean, you only go through life once, as far as we know. If you can, you know, have these experiences that enhance your spirituality, your mind, your body, you know, why wouldn't you do that if you could, rather than just, you know, be a slave to the routine? That's what it's about.
You're listening to World Footprints Radio with Ian and Tanya Fitzpatrick. We are speaking to Raw Travel host Robert Rose about authentic travel and transformative experiences. Visit the show page on our website at worldfootprints.com for a link to the Raw Travel website.
So what has been one of the most transformative travel experiences you've had?
You know, one of these days I'm going to look back and I'm going to really appreciate what I'm going through right now. It's like anything. When you're in the moment, you know, I'm worried about deadlines and editing and getting shows in the can and, you know, budgets and all the challenges of being an independent production. But, you know, I've had so many transformative experiences so many times where I'm like, oh, my God, this is just surreal. But the most tangible one And I knew going in that it was going to be like that. But it was when I went to the Pine Ridge Indian Reservation in South Dakota and just hung out with the Native Americans there. That's the poorest county in the United States. They have a lot of issues, you know, with alcohol abuse and poverty. And, you know, life expectancy is the lowest in the Western Hemisphere outside of Haiti, which blew my mind. And most distressingly, what really got to me and why I knew it was going to be an emotional experience was the kids and teens, you know, killing themselves, committing suicide. So obviously it's bigger than poverty because I've seen poverty like I just saw in Africa or in the Philippines. Just, you know, poverty that we don't even really experience in the U.S. And, you know, you can't say that in Pine Ridge they're as poor as those people, you know, in other countries, but they for some reason are more hopeless. And that's what I thought was such a tragedy there, and it is a tragedy. But what I found when I got there was that there's so much love and hope and people trying to turn the situation around, both from the reservation itself and from travelers and people who've been there and heard about it and have said, you know, this is unacceptable to me. I'm not going to sit idly by while this happens in my own country. And that filled me with a lot of hope, and I still get, you know, emotional when I talk about it.
When you're going on location to some of these wonderful places, how much of the location do you really get to enjoy whilst working?
Well, I think it's a double-edged sword because definitely you're fast traveling through places, which I prefer slow travel. You can take your time and really get to know people and settle in and feel like a local, if you will. So we don't really get the opportunity to do that because we're really, you know, moving fast and up against the deadline. And that creates some friction, especially when you're in places like Africa or Central America or even Pine Ridge, where people may not necessarily answer emails promptly. You know, they're on a different time frame than we are. But I also, on the flip side, have these experiences that I might most likely would not have as a traveler without a camera. And these are those mind-blowing experiences that just, I was in Norway, for example, and I saw the fjords. And then we went and to this farmer who raises sheep and he makes his own cheese. And then I hung out with a guy who makes shoes by hand still. And I'm like, most likely if I were just traveling through here, I wouldn't see all this in one day. So it's sort of like I got my mind blown to where I'm sleeping that night. And I'm like, this was one of those days where you're just like, this is amazing. I hope I can hang on to this feeling. And I've had a few days like that. And that's when I really know, you know, how blessed I am. And so I try not to complain too much because most people I know would love to have this quote-unquote job. They don't realize how much work goes into it, how little I get out of it in terms of finances, at least at the moment. You know, but the reality is it sure beats sitting in an office, you know, or checking emails, which I have to do plenty of as well.
What do you want viewers to experience when watching your show, Raw Travel?
I want them to first of all know that I'm not a travel expert. I'm just a travel enthusiast, just a normal, regular guy, not a professional TV host either. And I want them to be inspired to take travel, to do it on their own, not to simply just be entertained by watching myself. Of course, I want them to be entertained, but more than entertained, I want them to be inspired. And if I can inspire a few people to get a passport or to use their passport more often, and to think a little differently about how they travel and live their lives, then, you know, mission accomplished.
Check your local listings to find where you can view Raw Travel or visit rawtravel.com for more information. We also have a direct link on this show page at worldfootprints.com.